Thank you, everybody, for having for staying around and hearing me and the rest of the speakers talk. I just want to ask everybody to put their hands together once again for Darren and all the volunteers here. That's tremendous job. Darren, you're going to be very dearly missed here in Vancouver, and all your work and dedication to the cause is tremendous. Thank you. All right. So yeah, that's me anyway. So I'm the West Coast Campaign Officer for the Animal Alliance Environment Voters Party of Canada. I know that's quite a long title, and unfortunately, just try to get, you know, a media outlet to put that at the bottom of the screen when you're talking or something. They never wanted to do it because it's just way too long. But that's something that we're working on too, is the name. But regardless, so who am I? Why am I here? Well, first of all, I'm an activist and an advocate, and then lastly, I'm a politician. But I really see these things as fluid. I don't see them as one piece or the other. I think that we all have the potential to be involved in politics, be involved in activism and advocacy in a way that's meaningful to us. And that's essentially why I got into politics. About 3-4 years ago, people that I was working with in Victoria said, you know, nobody ever really pays attention to what is happening with our advocacy, what is happening with our activism. And so I decided that it was important to create something that would be a place for us to get our message out to the world that we are doing something. Because in the last couple of years, social media has really exploded in terms of their coverage of these issues, but it's still very taboo in a lot of ways, and dealing with the topics from a critical perspective is even more so. So back in the day, one day I just took a picture of a cat off the internet and traced it and came up with that little guy, which some of you might have seen on social media popping up. Originally it was the Raging Kuching, which nobody knew what a kuching was, but it just means cat in Indonesian, and it's kind of an inside joke. So we decided to change it to the critical cat, and then once again our organizing efforts changed, and so now it's the Victoria Animal News, which covers animal-related topics. Basically, it's news by activists for activists. And we don't want to just be dependent upon mainstream media as our main sources of information. We want to create that information. We want to have control of it, and that's the power of independent media, is that we can get our message out and not the ones that the mainstream media, you know, manufactures after the fact. So that was really important. I also work with the Vancouver Island Vegan Association, Island Animal Liberation, Victoria Animal News, and Victoria Horse Alliance. And if I could just ask everybody, once again, sorry, to give an applause, because I just have to say I couldn't do any of this without my partner, Corey, who does a tremendous amount of work and is completely unrecognized. Very unrecognized for all her contribution to this, just because I stand up here and you know, get a podium and such, doesn't mean that that work isn't important. So yeah, and besides that, I'm also a mental health and addictions worker for Island Health. So I work in withdrawal management services, I work in detox, I work in the Sobering Center and various other recovery related aspects of homelessness and drug addiction. So, why am I up here? Well, because something happened essentially last year. The party leader of Animal Alliance Environment Voters was out here working on the deer call issue that was going on in Oak Bay, which has happened on the mainland here in Cranbrook and in the Okanagan. And essentially, you know, I didn't even know at the time that they had a party, and probably, how many of you have actually heard of the Animal Alliance Environment Voters Party besides, you know, showing up here today hearing about this? Yeah, so a few people, and there's lots of people here from out of town, maybe Ontario, where they have more of a presence and such, but in general, a lot of people on the West Coast haven't heard about us until the election. The Strait did an article on me over in Vancouver, which gave some perspective to people, but otherwise not you. So it's a long name, I know, but it's a pretty simple concept. So bring animal advocacy into politics. Make it a primary focus of what is happening in our world. Bring the animal issues into the political discourse. So make sure that when we talk to, when we're at debates, when we're talking with politicians, what's being covered, the news issues during an election, is that animals are included in that discussion and are not just kind of relegated to, well, that only matters kind of when we're getting a certain bill passed right now, and then you can get away with all the terrible things that you let you know, various lobby groups do to animals the rest of the year or whatever. So basically how it was formed was, there used to be a law that you needed 40 candidates to run in an election. And the Communist Party actually was the one who fought this politically, or through the legal system, and they managed to get it down that you just need one candidate to run in the federal election now, and so that opened up the opportunity for an animal party to have its place. Now, that is a huge democratic leap, but there's still a long way to go before we can actually have real engagement, and I'll talk about that a bit more later. So, back in 2006, parties started, so it's actually our 10-year anniversary this year, and in one candidate round, the party leader, Liz White, who also runs the Animal Alliance in Canada, which is a 25-year-old animal advocacy organization in Canada, based out of Ontario, and this year, or last year I should say, we ran 8 candidates, which was about consistent with the last election previous to that. So it's something that has grown a fair bit and takes a fair bit of work on the side, but it's something that we're continuing to try to evolve and reimagine. And as I said, my participation in this is fairly new as well, so I'm hoping to talk to you today and get some other activists and advocates involved in this, because something that I find we often talk about is that the ideas are not just something that any political party can solve on their own. The problems in our world today are not something that any political party will solve on their own. Sometimes I go to debates and people say, well, we are gonna end this, we're gonna end homelessness, we're gonna end poverty, you know, we're gonna end environmental devastation. It is not the political parties that do this, but they are the gatekeepers in many ways to the resources that will allow us to do that. But in most cases, it's the NGOs, it's the nonprofit organizations on the ground that are doing a lot of the work and don't get recognized. And so it's important that we bring them into the conversation when we talk about making a difference in the world today. So this is the team. So Liz on the right, or my right, I guess. And Vicky and Leah, there's 4 cats, which are not pictured, of course. They're also a big part of the office. They're in Toronto. I was just there last week. And it's a lot of fun being out there. And it's a great team of people. They're really dedicated. I mean, they live it day and night. So yes, animals and politics, why I'm here. So how to run a political campaign centered around animal rights. So, anybody have an idea how you do this off the top of their head? Okay. Talk about animals. Yes. Well, I didn't know how I was going to do this either, but I thought, I got to figure it out, right? Because nobody's doing it. And even you know, what was going on with other candidates, it wasn't maybe a total engagement of how embedded animals are in our society. And that was something coming from a sociological and philosophical background I really wanted to engage in. And I really wanted to hold the other political parties accountable for their perspectives and their ideologies and their policies and how they weren't dealing with the whole picture by not including non-human animals. So, and I was just thinking about this a lot. And this one idea is that the animal is the political. So how many people know who Aristotle is or heard of him at some point? You probably don't know him personally, but he, you know, ancient Greek philosopher, basically said, you know, humans are political animals. And He obviously, he meant that in a very exclusionary way, that a political ability, a rational ability that animals didn't have in his mind. Now, you know, you jump a lot further forward into history, and in the 1960s, the student and second wave feminist movement bring forward the idea that the personal is the political. And this is kind of furthering on the, building on the idea by C. Wright Mills that of the sociological imagination, right? So our personal experiences relate to the social world, to the political world, and they're enmeshed with one another. We can't just say, well, what happens to me isn't political in some way. And so I kind of want to take that back a step and say, how is the animal the political? How are animals embedded in our politics? And we as animals have to acknowledge that what we do, our policies, our way of living, is extremely political at every step of the way. So this kind of furthers it that animals are excluded continually from our interpretation of society. And there's, I think, an excellent talk yesterday about how animals have their own culture, they have their own societies, and they're entrenched in that, in our society together. It's not just our society with them in it as objects in the world, they are subjects within that world. And so the illusion of civilization is founded upon the exploitation of animals. And I think I don't mean to in any way discount the fact that the exploitation of other human animals is just as important when we talk about that. But it's the idea that there are those that can be animalized in a way, because animals are generally that lowest common denominator that we move animals, that we try to reduce all the other people that we want to marginalize or exploit into. We animalize them, we use language that that dehumanizes them, right? Even that word, dehumanizing, is based on the idea that they're basically being turned into animals and aren't worthy of somehow human respect, as if animals deserve less respect somehow. And so this is an issue, and of course, everywhere you look in history, animals are excluded as being a part of history, and yet somewhere in the background, it is the bodies of animals that are the labor, that are building our cities, they are the food that has energized, I guess, the people in so many ways, and there's obviously exceptions to that as well. But the idea of civilization is built upon the illusion that everything is okay as well, that everything is, that there isn't violence in the world. And this is really, to me, what politicians are unfortunately framed as, and what they're often about, is about convincing people that everything is okay, and when it's really not. It's about convincing people that animals are treated really well and that they really care about animals, while at the same time, the slaughterhouse floor is stained red with blood. Those are the kind of things that we need to recognize in our politics. So it is an injustice to not include them in the discussion of politics, because they are a part of our world, and we have to, our policies and our politics affect them as well. So I truly believe that animals are going to be, if they're not already, the single most powerful political topic in the world today, just because of how profound their lives are in our world, but how unrecognized they are. And I'm going to get more into how powerful that is, but animals are used in politics, but they're not used in a way that is meaningful or acknowledges their importance to politics. They're used as commodities, they're used as props, and I'm going to show you some more about that later as well. But they're not votes, and that's the problem for animals right now as well, is that saying that you're going to address animal issues, saying that you're going to have stronger protections for animals, right now, that is not something that people are voting for. And in fact, politicians tend to be more worried that they're going to lose votes if they support strong animal legislation or laws, because they feel like that's going to hurt. They're going to get pushback from lobby groups such as the meat and dairy industry or fur industry or whatever it is. So we'll see more about that as well. So how do we incorporate animals into our politics? Well, you have to have, like I mentioned before, a sociological imagination. So you have to be creative with how you imagine the two things intertwined in our discourse. So there's essentially no political topic that can't be framed through an animal, critical animal studies lens. We have to transcend the human-animal divide. We can't keep talking about environmentalism as if it doesn't include animal agriculture. We can't keep talking about the oceans as if they're not full of cetaceans, fish, other marine life. We can't keep talking about the forest as if it's not full of birds and deer and other animals as well. We have to talk about agriculture, logging, healthcare, the economy, homelessness, all these different issues, and see where animals are situated within. So it is up to us in that respect to disrupt the normative political discourse. So the normative discourse frames animals as commodities in mainstream politics, and I'm about to show you some pictures. Nothing graphic really, although it's kind of graphic, might be funny, but part of what we're trying to do by bringing this into the discussion is create a profound awkwardness, I like to call it. So we actually want to have politicians be off-center. We want them to not know what to say in these situations because we want them to feel uncomfortable and feel unprepared to deal with these issues, because they should be. They should know how to respond to these issues. They should know, they should have stronger policies on animal issues. And so if they don't, then we need to hold them accountable for that, and we need to show them that there's people that are going to hold them to task without compromise to a degree. So here's one of Thomas Mulclair, who, I don't know if this is what lost the NDP the election or not, but probably not. But you know, here he is, just stuffing some milk or some formula of some kind into, this is a 2-day old baby calf, and so he's being used as a prop, right? Or this baby calf is being used as a prop for political gain. And it, to me, when I saw this, I was immediately disturbed. I don't know, does it disturb anybody else in this room to think of that baby calf is 2 days old, taken away to be turned into a show for people to say, and what does this say politically? Anybody?
No one cares.
Okay, maybe a hand. 20 responses here. Somebody, yes. Yeah, absolutely, that's right. So it's okay to do whatever we want to animals, but it also says, I support the dairy industry, right? And so by doing this great photo op here, Thomas Mulclair is saying, look, we care about jobs for dairy workers, and we're gonna do whatever we can to protect that. And this was probably in the context of the TPP, which some of you might be aware of. The Trans-Pacific Partnership deal, just kind of like NAFTA, I don't know if you're aware of that. And basically, it would have really hurt, or a lot of politicians were speaking about how it's going to hurt our meat and dairy industry. And it's not that it's going to really hurt our meat and dairy industry in that it's going to shut them down necessarily, but it's going to hurt jobs, it's going to allow people the importation of foreign meat and dairy and such. So people are concerned about, or the dairy and meat industry is quite concerned about the effect it's gonna have on their bottom line. Of course, nobody's concerned about the animal ethics of that and the types of less stringent regulations for the industry, or just even the essential fact that this is happening at all, that 2-day-old baby calves are being taken away from their mom for something that is actually toxic to people and is actually killing people and is actually costing our healthcare probably billions of dollars a year, and yet, instead, have your glass of milk, right? So this is a major concern. So this is Elizabeth May. She's hanging out at the Calgary Stampede, okay? So, and you know, yes, she's, I don't know, she's making pancakes here. So the problem here, okay, anybody wanna tell me what the problem here is? Okay, so it's a rodeo. So it's a place of violence against animals, right? It's a place where animals are subject to trauma, stress, and violence. And essentially, it's like, well, you know, so what, right? I mean, it is a very political statement when somebody goes to a place of violence against animals and doesn't not go to make a statement that they don't support, right? So to me, that is a huge, very political issue that also needs to be addressed. Now this next one, it's a bit trickier. There's our old fearless leader, Stephen Harper. Now, has anybody seen Stephen Harper covered in kittens or puppies? I picked this one because the dog's biting him, but there's lots of pictures of Stephen Harper with kittens because his wife adopts kittens or fosters them and such, and they kind of have this thing going, a big PR stunt. But this is just another, and I could put much worse pictures of Stephen Harper, but I wanted to give some diversity to what was being put up here, and I wanted to show that, you know, animals again are being used as props, as cute and cuddly things. There's a bunch of other pictures of him with koalas and pandas and other animals as well. And so the problem is that once again, he, in this case, you know, he's trying to frame himself as just a nice guy who likes cats and dogs. You know, really easygoing. It doesn't matter that he's promoting, you know, Canada Goose, or that he's promoting, hunting in the Arctic or things like that. He's passing all these really damaging environmental policies, Bill C-51, other things. But I mean, hey, look, puppies love him. So the next one, it's gonna hit, you know, closer to home, perhaps, because, well, it's kind of what we're stuck with now. And as you know, I'm sure people seen this picture before, probably. Yeah, it's kind of infamous, and it's gonna follow him around probably for the rest of his life. So he's drenched in, I believe it's coyote fur, and... Yes, so they're close. And so this is gonna I'm gonna just talk a little bit about Bill C-246. So Trudeau and his father before him as well were certainly keen fur wearers and such, and they didn't really care. I mean, Trudeau has said he doesn't, like, he supports the fur industry. He's not really concerned about that. So this is hugely political, and you can think about this in another way, is that the animal is political, but when you see that, you know, baby seal, let's say, right, the harp seal, before it gets clubbed on the head, or, and you think about what is the political nature of that seal in our world. It is not just that it affects me, right? So it can't just be a personal thing. It can't just be a selfish interest in that, well, I don't like seeing that seal being killed, so therefore, it matters in the world. Is that our politics, our policies around the seal hunt are political, and they affect that seal on its own terms, in its own way, without us mattering in that equation, right? And so it's really important for us to address how political each animal's life is. And same with these coyotes. I mean, every coyote cares about its life and cares about keeping its own fur and doesn't want to see Justin Trudeau and his family wrapped up in the fur. So just, I hope it's clear. So opportunities for engagement, yes, they're pretty endless. So you can pick just about anything, and I've just put a few basic topics up there. But it's surprising, and people often don't really get, you know, well, how do you really talk about it? So the environment, how do you think you incorporate animals into the environment? How do you not incorporate them? Is there an environment without animals? No, there isn't, not really. Not one that I can imagine living on. I guess the moon, maybe. But, ecologically, our other animals are, you know, enmeshed in our conception of the environment, and yet we don't talk about them. They're not included. So it's pretty easy for me, and I'll get into more of this later, but it's something that seems so, like, just should be first nature or second nature, because it's excluded. The economy. How many people know how much money is given to the oil companies every year, roughly, as subsidies? Okay, so 3 billion direct, 30 billion indirect. So how much do you think is given to the animal agriculture industries? Well, somewhere about 8 to 12 billion a year. Yeah. So how much impact does animal agriculture have on the environment? And how much impact does the oil industry have on the environment? Would you say that it is at least reasonably close, if not perhaps, animal agriculture might have even more of an impact, right? Now, that's easy for me to say to this room, okay? But there's other rooms that aren't so cozy to that idea. So, but nobody's talking about those subsidies. Nobody mentions them, right? So that's what I do, right? That's what our party's about. Is saying, why aren't you talking about these subsidies? Why aren't you talking about these issues? Why are you hiding that? Especially when you talk about directly, they might get 8 to 12 billion, but what is the cost again on healthcare? Right? Healthcare costs are always skyrocketing, and yet, how much money are, and you know, I work in a hospital, and we are feeding people garbage in hospitals. And to me, that is an injustice in itself. We are poisoning people in many ways. We obviously support technology and industry within the healthcare system that supports the use and exploitation and experimentation on non-human animals. And so there's so many levels to this. It goes on and on and on. Employment, we've talked today about how we bring in, you know, migrant workers to do these jobs in many cases, jobs that they're exploited in themselves, right? And so there's more layers about it. And that's something else I want to mention is that, you know, Animal Alliance Environment Voters is not just a party about the animals. We are a social justice party as well, because we see the struggle as inextricably linked, and we have to speak to both for us to do justice and to maintain our integrity as a party. Otherwise, we're really not doing our job. So, government as well. So I'll just touch basically quickly on government as well. So government, anybody know what kind of government we have right now? What kind of political system we have right now? Electoral system, I should say. Yes, first past the post, right. So, would people say that gets us just results? No, probably not. So, right now, and I'm gonna talk more about this later a little bit, just touch on it, but the only way we're really going to deal with the injustice in our world is by dealing, first of all, with the injustice in our political structures, right? And with the electoral system in particular. We know we just spent many years under somewhat tyrannical rule of Stephen Harper. Don't be lulled if you are. I'm not sure how many people are still, especially after Elbowgate, but of how still corrupt and messed up our political system is, just because the Liberals are in Justin Trudeau's, and the same problems will persist. And we're already seeing, you know, the cracks in the surface in terms of how that manifests. Education, well, you know, we can talk about education, how we, you know, experiment on animals, again, our national policies. I know education is a provincial issue, but education, there's no reason why federal politicians can't be involved in how we treat animals, especially when we start looking at the criminal code and the changes that we can make and how they impact the ability of provinces to, provide education, especially if we say you can't experiment on animals, then then that can't happen at those different levels to a greater degree. So housing, I'm going to get into that more. I have a story for you about that. But let's move on for now. Do I have video on this, Darren, wherever you are? Okay, so I just want to give you a quick example of kind of what happened. I can click on it. Okay, well, we'll try it. So this was... Okay, just a quick setup for this. Okay, so basically, anybody know the Dogwood Initiative? Yeah, okay. So the Dogwood Initiative, they were hosting a debate on the environment, okay? And so I kind of petitioned them and said, look, you know, like, because when you're not a mainstream party, it's really hard to get invited to debates. So I said, look, you know, I'm talking about the environment in a way that nobody else is talking about the environment. Do you really just want to have three candidates up there that are just, you know, shaking each other's hands and the same thing, right, that people have already heard time and time before, or can I come participate? They said, no, we really only want people who are in a position to get elected, right? And so I was disappointed, and I can accept that, though. I don't take it personally, because there's other parties as well that don't get invited, so that's fine. I was a little disappointed, though, again, when I showed up at the event and saw that, because of course the conservative candidates don't show up to, or weren't showing up to the debates, but instead of having like a real person come speak, like myself, or maybe the Communist Party or whatever, instead they just had a teddy bear in place of the conservative candidate. That's kind of a joke, I guess, but I thought, you know, they're not doing anything to really further the discussion on the issue. And so I did get the opportunity, though, to ask a question. So this is the question I asked. It's not me speaking, but somebody speaking for me. And I was there.
The exploitation of non-human animals in the animal and agricultural industries, not including marine life and aquaculture, accounts for at least one quarter of GHG emissions. This is on a par or exceeds the transportation industry as a whole. What will your party do to address both the ethical and environmental concerns raised due to these systematically abusive and polluting industries?
I just want to give you a chance to hear their responses for yourselves.
Thanks, sir, for the question. This is part, I think, of our suite of things we're trying to do for food security. And one of the things we want to do is make Canada a leader in sustainable agriculture by supporting research that looks at greenhouse gas emissions from the agricultural sector. You know, meat production, as you all know, if you talk about it, produces an awful lot of methane, and we have to deal with it head on. We should, as part of our sustainable agriculture, promote animal welfare, which of course is the point of your question. I think we need to look carefully at whether or not there is cruelty on feedlots, for example, and we need to be very much aware of the ethical issues that are there. But we need to put together an entire strategy to deal with the sustainable agriculture sector that should consider, among other things, the issues that you raised.
Does cruelty happen on feedlots? No. Do we need more research into finding out that really happens? Probably not. But anyway, so Murray does a pretty good job, but he really, you know, skirts the issues. He talks about animal welfare. We need, you know, I guess, you know, humane meat kind of alternatives, that kind of thing. Murray's a long time vegetarian. He's a really good guy. He's a great politician, actually. He was watching him in debates and stuff. Was just like, that's the person I'll talk like someday, but not ideologically. There's a long way to go. The NDP have to deal with some of these issues politically, and of course, there's a lot of jobs wrapped up in it. So that's.
Joanne, would you like to respond?
Well, when Jordan raised this first, I was concerned about where we stood in the Green Party on it, so I did make some inquiries, and it is part of our policy that we will adopt animal welfare legislation to prevent inhumane treatment of farm animals, including intensive factory farming methods. And the Act will set minimum standards for treatment and have a timetable for phasing that out. But as Jordan, I'm sure, would say if he was here, that's not enough. What we can continue to look at is biogas plants to take the methane and make it usable, and address the question of animal diets, which is also an issue that is adding to this problem. So there are remedies, how we're using water, how we're using soil, they're worth dealing with and looking into, and I certainly thank Jordan for raising it.
Joanne was great, Joanne Roberts, Victoria candidate for the Green Party. She did an amazing job, and you know, she was I was really close with her throughout most of the election. But once again, I mean, the main language being used is welfareism, we need to, you know, treat the animals better. Not really addressing the issues. She does mention that if I was there, that I would say something about animal diets, which I'm guessing she means like veganism, but it's not a commitment in any way to saying that that's what that they actually support, right? So I just find it interesting to look at these things.
Thank you, Jordan, and thanks for joining us tonight. As a daughter of a veterinarian who was constantly working for the improvement of how animals are treated on farms and not to exploit them, I certainly understand where you're coming from. And we do need to look at and do more research on how much of our greenhouse gases are caused by animal husbandry. Part of what we're talking about in some of the tax credits is looking at ways that farmers can farm more efficiently, more organically, and more environmentally friendly. And any farmer who wants to step up and say,
okay, so I'm just gonna stop her there because there's nothing, because she actually goes way off topic and it's just kind of, I don't know. But yeah, once again, welfare's policies and the idea that, once again, we need to invest in technology to mitigate these issues. We don't need to look at the ethical and substantial issues that are already present in animal agriculture itself. It's that, it's a very kind of tepid response. And so all of them are very concerned about making a clear response. And this is one of the biggest issues that comes up in politics and elections, is that politicians hate being like 100% committal to things often, because they just think, well, you know, if I say that, then people are gonna hold me to it. So it's better if I give a wishy-washy response. And I'll be perfectly honest with you about something, and it, I know it can be a touchy subject, but somebody called me up and really close to the election, they said, Jordan, I really like what you're doing. I really, you know, I think it's great you're talking about these animal issues, you're talking about environmental issues, social justice issues and such, but what's your opinion on abortion? And so when somebody calls me and asks me that, the first thing I'm thinking, well, okay, you know, what do they want from me, right? And so I thought, well, you know, I could answer this two ways. I can kind of sidestep the issue and say, you know, oh, well, you know, there's, you know, lots of reasons to consider option A, consider option B. But, you know, I just said, look, I said, I support a woman's right to choose. And I think that we need to invest in education and resources and safety and make sure that people have access to services and are aware of the services and can make a choice for themselves. And I think they shouldn't be scared of reprisal for making those choices as well. I think that's just as important. And we need continuity across the country to deal with those things. And yeah, and as expected, he said, Jordan, I don't agree with you. And he said, I'm not gonna vote for you because I can't. But he said, you know what, you're the only person who gave me a straight answer on that of all the political parties. And I was perfectly fine with that. You know, I don't feel bad about losing a vote. I wouldn't feel bad about losing the interest of anyone because of my values. If somebody said, you know, if we lose the integrity of why we're doing this, if we lose the integrity of our values, then what's the point of being political, right? If we compromise away the values, if we compromise away the thing that gives us an identity, then why does it matter, right? So to me, that's a really essential part of being political, is just being honest about who you are and going from there. So I was talking about how animals are political and how they are incorporated into different aspects of our society. I hadn't seen this picture for a really long time when I brought it up, but during the election, this darling, precious, came into our lives briefly, and one day Corey called me up and said, you know, it was really early in the morning, she was out walking our dog, and there was this cat walking through a field, and just like very slowly, wasn't running away from Doug, or just seemed completely oblivious to what was going on. And so she said, you know, come pick her up right away, and so we did. And she was just skin and bones, her fur was all matted. She was breathing really quite laboriously. She seemed to just kind of be passing almost in and out of consciousness at times as well. So she was in really bad shape, but she was beautiful. And we took her to, you know, the vet, and she ended up at animal control, and they kept her there for a few days, but she had liver failure, and so she died a few days later. So I had to do a talk on homelessness a few days after, and I started out talking about how I had known someone who had come to me off the street and had obviously lived a really hard life, and her struggle, and I framed it without saying that she was a cat until the very end. And everybody kind of, when I said it at the end, everybody was kind of like, what? Why is he talking about cats at a homelessness event? Anybody guess why? She's homeless. Yeah, pretty straightforward, isn't it? And so we often talk about homelessness just in the context, especially at the political level, that homelessness only matters if it's affecting people. And we don't talk about it when it's affecting other animals, which there's probably at least 500,000 homeless animals every year in Canada, and alone. And they're suffering. And there's also a great deal of cruelty in Canada every year happening behind closed doors in Canada. And we don't ever hear about it, really, except maybe the worst cases in the news and such. But the reality is that it's systemic violence against animals everywhere, and homelessness is also. And these are just cats and dogs. When I say 500,000 animals, I'm probably just talking about cats and dogs. That doesn't even include all the other animals that are homeless, unwanted, abused, taken in, and otherwise. And I mean, I could tie that into the fact that you can barely find a place to rent that allows cat and dog. And that's also an issue that's tied to politics. And so Precious made a political impact in my world, and she is a political actor. She's a part of our political sphere. And so it was really important for me to include her, because she is part of our world. Now, I work with homeless people every day, and I knew that the people there were going to be people from that community, and people who work in that community, who for the most part probably don't, you know, from my experience, don't talk about animal homelessness. Although a great number of homeless people have animals in their lives, and that's often not talked about either. So I brought her in, and then later, I don't have a picture of her, but I talked about, and I tried to make a connection, but I said, look, there's another person in my life, and her name's Lily, okay? And so Lily is a cat that comes into my work often, or she used to, or probably she can say that she still does, but because you're not supposed to be there, but She just walks in from the back, and you know what? She makes a difference in people's lives every day because they love her. She comes in and they pet her and they spend time with her and they're calming to her, and she just hangs out and she goes home. And it's extremely, you know, it's a great experience for these people who get stigmatized and get exploited and get abused and, you know, probably get just pushed on from every angle all the time. And she just makes a difference in their lives because she's non-judgmental. She doesn't care, as long as you got pets, pretty much. And to me, I connected, I said, look, at the end of the day, all any of us really want is to be treated with dignity and respect and kindness. And that's exactly what she does. She does it more probably than a lot of people, a lot of vegans I know do. And so, to me, she needs to be included in this discussion as well. So that was really important to me. So, here's a little face-off I had with David Suzuki. Now, David Suzuki, everybody knows who David Suzuki is, right? It's hard not to if you live in Canada, I think, but... I was at this debate and talking about, you know, environmentalism again. And I was talking about animal issues, and David came up to me and he said, after the debate, first thing he says to me, he doesn't say anything at all, like Ellis doesn't introduce himself, probably doesn't have to, I guess. He says, what about plants? I said, what about plants? And he says, yeah, what about plants? You know, what about protecting the biodiversity of plants in our world? I said, yeah, it's extremely important, of course. And I said, probably one of the greatest contributors to the destruction of natural habitats where plants are being protected is animal agriculture. And then it was time for me to ask him a question. And he kind of said, yeah, okay, sure, you know, to that last one. I said, so you signed the LEAP Manifesto, right? You're a signatory to that. You took part in the LEAP Manifesto. People know what that is, LEAP Manifesto? Okay, LEAP Manifesto is something created by Naomi Klein, a big social justice kind of advocate, and Abby Lewis, which is he's an NDP kind of insider person. Anyway, it's saying that, you know, this is supposed to be this kind of manifesto for a new world. What's that? Oh, five? Oh, okay. Okay. So, anyway, I said, you know, David, what? I said, you know, why aren't animals on that document, right? Why is nowhere in that document, if you're talking about social justice, you're talking about protecting the environment, all these things, why aren't you talking about animal agriculture? Why aren't you dealing with that? He didn't have a response at all. He just, that was it, right? And so to me, that's hugely political when you're talking about a revolution in politics, the revolution in the way that we live our lives, social justice, and you can't even include in one line animals. So to me, that needs to be addressed. And I find this political, and you probably guess why. I'm going to skip over that because I'm running out of time. But, you know, what I want to say here just quickly is that we are not in the middle of climate change. We're in the middle of a climate crisis. And climate change really neglects the urgency of the situation. We need to start addressing it head on and not just kind of saying, well, we need to start changing the way we do things. No, it's a crisis. We need to act now, not 10 years from now. So I want to talk about Bill C-246, but I'm going to pass over that right now because there's going to be a lot of stuff coming out. I'm going to do some more stuff on my own, maybe write something about that. But basically, it's a bill that would stop the importation of shark fins attached to the shark, stop the importation of dog and cat fur, create a new offense, brutal and vicious killing, which would be in line with other offenses in Canada. All these really good things, but you know, nothing overly profound in a lot of ways. Like they're actually asking for very little, but it's going to be killed by the Liberal government, primarily the Chief Justice, their Minister of Justice. Jody Wilson-Raybould and Justin Trudeau and the cabinet are going to vote against this bill. For their part, the NDP will be voting for the bill, which outdoes the cabinet, but you're probably going to see the Liberals try to kill it anyway, and the Conservatives as well. So it's really, it's quite sad, and that's a whole other talk in itself, really. So policy, the other issue that I really want to touch on is that no other party is talking about the issue of capitalism right? So it's one thing to talk about animals, but it's another thing to talk about animals in our current economic system. We don't support the idea of capitalism and the idea that we can have this never-ending, infinite growth kind of model of production. We believe in what we try to promote is a solid-state economy, or the idea that our economy should be balanced within the ecological limits of our world. So our economy has to be enmeshed with our environment. And in that sense, we can't make decisions economically that impact that. So you can't have animal agriculture because it's not sustainable. So stop talking about sustainable agriculture. Stop talking about sustainable oil and gas industry. Stop talking about these things and move beyond, right? Look for the alternatives. We promote a plant-based lifestyle straight up. We don't hold anything back. We promote veganism. That's part of our policy. We promote a basic living wage for all so that everyone can participate in society, everyone can be involved, because we can't expect anyone to become vegan or to care about animal advocacy issues in many ways if they can't even have a roof over their head or find basic, reasonably priced food. We need to empower people economically as well as with education about these issues, but we can't be hard on people for not being able to participate in what we want them to participate in. And what Lauren said before was really powerful about that. Free tuition as well, of course, for the kids is always good. Well, for everybody, of course. I also work with a group called Basic Income Victoria to promote a basic income. And we've actually got Victoria to be the first city in Canada that actually is written to the Prime Minister saying that we want to partake in a national sort of trial run of that in Victoria. So anyway, I'll just finish up quickly. Other countries, Netherlands, they're already doing it, okay, what we're trying to do right now. They have two representatives in the Senate. They get over 200,000 votes. Germany had over 300,000 votes. You've got parties in the UK. You've got the Humane Party now down in the States. Portugal has a representative. I think Spain has a representative. I mean, all over Cyprus, I think, also has a representative, which is like this tiny little island, like it's half an island actually, and they still have a representative. But it's a proportional representation system that allows this to be, and we're asking and we're going to be fighting for a mixed member proportional representation electoral system as well to empower people, really, and to empower all animals into this world. So what we really need in this regard, I'll finish with, is a revolution of mind. On these issues, the status quo is not enough. It's not going to stop the environmental devastation of the climate crisis that we're currently in. It's not going to protect animals. We need a revolution of mind. And what we need is activists and advocates from across the country to come together and band with this party to make it a reality, because this isn't just about politics. It's about activism, it's about advocacy, and it's about bringing that discourse and language into the political sphere. So I'll just finish with this. We must be the actors in our own revolution. Our audience is just as much other animals as it is ourselves. Our ability to create a new interpretation of what is possible is limited only by our ability to overcome ourselves. In this enmeshed fate, we are condemned to join in the charade of politics, but yet we may overthrow its design if we hold on relentlessly to our integrity and our common animality. And I'll leave you with that for now. Thank you very much for your time.